Pastor Chris Aaron Rice, and I'm here in front of our Marshfield Center, where we have a free store, and we have several men who are living out here in community together, and they're part of our residential training program. And I'm here with Daniel. Daniel, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I've lived in Missouri my whole life. I grew up in St. Louis, and here I am. The Lord led me out here to the NLEC. I've been through a lot in the last 5 years, alcohol relapses and homelessness, and I'm so glad to be here with a roof over my head.
So you've been in our program for about a week, and you said that the Lord led you here. Tell us a little bit about your relationship with God and with Jesus.
Well, I know God created everything, and he brought his son here to wash away our sins with his blood, and I'm just every day I'm just so thankful with gratitude that that it was all done for me.
So your sins have been washed away by the blood of Jesus, and now you have newness of life. You have new life, which is why we call it New Life Evangelistic Center.
Correct.
So tell us a little bit about Dan, the old Dan, before you came to know Christ.
Well, I didn't have a whole lot of faith, and I've always believed in God and Jesus, and knew the stories about Jesus in the Bible and how he saved the world, and I was an alcoholic, and I was a functioning alcoholic, and now that's all behind me.
Yeah. So Jesus set you free from your dependence on alcohol. You no longer have to turn to the bottle to function. Now you turn to Jesus, right?
That is correct.
Yeah. How do you feel now that how does your body even feel now that that's true?
Well, my body's thanking me a lot, because I was with alcohol dependency, I was killing myself. I came close to getting diabetes and having liver damage.
So Daniel, now that you're out here, you said it's a lot more quiet. What are you able to do out here? What's your life like out here right now?
Well, I'm able to reflect away from the big city and all the noise and the gunshots and the violence and the traffic jams, and now I'm able to come out here where it's, you know, be one with nature, where it's nice and peaceful, and just reflect on my past and on my future.
What do you want your future to hold? What comes next for Daniel during the program and after the program?
Well, I know for one thing, I got to keep God with me every day. I need him. I've tried to do it on my own, and it's failed. So here I am, God, and use me any which way you can.
Yeah, and so you don't know quite yet how God's going to use you, but you want your whole life to be around your relationship with him, right?
That is correct.
Well, please be praying for Daniel and the other men who are out here in the Marshfield Center as they seek the Lord, as they do spend time out here in God's creation, but also working and ministering to others who come and use their free store. Thank you so much, Daniel, for talking with me, and God bless you as you
so
focus on him during this 1 year, okay?
Yes. Thank you so much.
Sometimes we use drugs or alcohol to numb some of the pain that we're going through. But the thing is that once you've done that and it wears off, the problem still is there. So, Andy, you've been using drugs and alcohol to numb the pain.
Yes, sir. The emotional pain of being out on the streets.
Okay. So it takes a toll.
Oh, yeah, it does. This being on the streets is the result of my drinking and drug use.
Okay. I appreciate you being open and honest about that. Most people would have shifted and blame shift somebody else. But you're saying you're responsible for the conditions that you're in, circumstances you're in.
Oh, absolutely. I put myself here.
Okay. Do you believe in Jesus?
Yes, sir, I do.
Okay. Is he your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you believe that he's there to pull you out of that pit?
Yes, sir. I do believe that he'd rather me not be here.
and I would, too. And I'm not trying to be cruel or mean, but... Yeah, what happens is that an individual comes here and he's homeless, and that one day turns into a week, that week turns into a month, that month turns into a year, and they can't see that they're actually prisoners here, because Satan has blinded them, right? So we want to see you gain freedom in Christ.
Yes, sir. That's one of the best pieces of advice that I've been given by a fellow homeless person is don't get too comfortable.
And that's what happens. You begin to look at things as being normal, like someone serving you food, using a restroom where you have to wait for someone else to vacate so you can use the restroom, having everything basically regimented to you and ordered to you, right? When to go to the free store, when to come in, when not to come in. What activities you can do here. And so after a while, it becomes normal.
Yes, sir. It does.
Okay. So do you know what needs to be done to get you out of here?
Yeah.
Right? Staying sober.
Yes, sir.
Right? Don't listen to the lies of the devil. Because he always promises us joy, peace, and love. But you may get it for a moment. It's instant gratification. And after that, it's gone.
Right? Yes, sir.
You've gotten high, right, to numb some of the pain, but the pain is still there.
Yes, sir. It's present.
Yeah. I'm going to pray for you that you will not listen to the lies of Satan when he comes and whispers in your ear and tells you that this is okay, that this is normal, that God doesn't see what you're doing, right? God sees all. He knows all. And he loves you, Andy.
Right? Well, thank you. I love him, too.
Okay. Well, to love him means to worship him and obey him.
Yes, sir.
Right? So I'm going to keep you in prayer. Now, you wanted a backpack. So I'm going to show, I was going to give up my backpack because these had not come in yet. This is my backpack. Okay? I was going to give my backpack up. And now, this looks at Andy. Okay, look at that.
It's like that's all my
it puts mine to shame. So I think I'm going to keep mine and give Andy this one here. This is a big backpack.
Yeah, I can use it.
Right, and it's strong and it's sturdy, much more sturdier than mine. So God has really blessed you today.
Yes, sir. It came out a good time, too, my last backpack.
Right. God bless you because he loves you.
Yes, sir.
Okay, and this is just a small demonstration of how he cares about you. You saw the backpacks when he came in, right?
Yes, sir, I did.
Right? And you were praying for a backpack, and I was going to give you mine because we didn't have any. So I'm glad God heard your cry and gave you an excellent, much, much more superior backpack.
It had to be more than a coincidence.
Yeah. It was God hearing your prayer and saying, here, my son, because I love you, I do this for you. Okay? So I want to thank you for being here today, and thank you for allowing us to show you the love of Christ.
Absolutely. Thank you, Martin.
Thank you. We eventually are the sum of our choices. If we make good choices, chances are we'll have a good life. But if we make bad choices, we will probably have a less than fruitful life. And so I'm joined here with Jeremiah, and you said to me that you made some bad choices.
Yes, sir.
What bad choices did you make?
Using drugs and taking that over my responsibilities.
Okay. So you use drugs and the drugs promised you what?
Promised me to take things away, but it just made things worse.
Okay. It promised to give you love, peace, happiness,
right.
Joy.
It didn't do any of that.
Okay. And when you came down from the high, you found out you still had problems.
Worse than I did before. It just seemed like it compounded everything. Just made it worse and worse.
Mm-hmm. It's under your drugs give you a delusion, yes, and they change your thoughts. And they bend what's reality. They twist reality into you believing that this is reality when it's not.
Yes, sir. It really fogs your, makes you feel like things are going to get better, but it just makes it worse. It really blinds you.
Right. See, I believe drugs are from the devil. And they open a gateway to the devil. And the devil cannot duplicate the promises of God because God promised you peace and love and joy and happiness, right? So the devil can't. He can imitate them for a moment. And then after that moment's gone, right, there's nothing else there.
Yes, sir. And having God in your life just really brings out the best. I mean, things happen better. And I found out the hard way, but I'm on that path right now.
I'm glad that you're on that path, the right path, right? You also asked me for a Bible. I'm going to hold this one up. This was, I believe, donated to us. And we need more Bibles.
Yes.
Right? The people here, my homeless brothers and sisters, are hungry for the Word. So if you got some Bibles, please bring them to 806 North Jefferson here in Springfield. Or give me a call at 417-866-3363. And what does the Word of God mean to you?
It means life. It means better things are going to happen. That's why I really feel.
Okay. Were you praying for a Bible?
Actually, I did last night. Honestly, not joking. I did. And it was just, it wasn't really an out loud thing. It was just, I was going to sleep and I'm like, hey, I really need a Bible. I wish I could get a Bible and look what happens.
Yeah. God answered.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
He answers because He loves us so deeply. Right? And He wants us to continue loving Him.
I wish I could have seen that a long time ago. You know, I mean, I've always had God in my life, but not close like He is now. Not totally in my soul, not totally in me. So it's different. It's different. And it feels good. You know, I mean, when I don't have nothing, it feels good.
Right. You have God.
Yes.
Right.
And He's going to take me wherever I need to go.
He will. He will. Yes. Trust Him.
Yes.
Okay. I want to thank you for being here today. Thank you for talking with us.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate it.
I'm here with Steve. Steve, you're also in our residential training program. How long have you been with us now?
About a month and a half.
Okay. So what are some of the things that God is really teaching you in this season of your life?
Well, I'm growing closer to God. I was separated from God, but I'm starting to get a relationship back with God again.
What's that look like?
Well, before I had the relationship, I was on the street, got there because I was doing things that I shouldn't have been doing. I was drinking, and now I'm not drinking and spending more time with the Word of God in prayer.
And as you read your Bible, what's one thing that you're really learning? Where are you reading your Bible, and what's going on there?
Right now I'm reading in Psalms, and I'm reading in James. I'm learning more ways to live my life as God wants me to live.
Yeah, James is a very practical book. It's only 5 chapters long, but there's so much rich practical lessons in there that we can learn and try to apply to our lives. Absolutely. And Psalms is a really, really phenomenal book as well, where we can really understand more of who God is, who we are, and how we're to live before Him. So Steve, what are some of the things, what are your responsibilities out here as you're here at New Life?
Well, we do a Bible study. Right now we're working on Larry Rice's book. I mow the yard and stuff, and to help take care of the free store.
So we got a free store, you've got yard work and work outside that you're doing. It's a lot more quiet out here than it is in Springfield, right?
Oh, yes. Very much quieter. It's peaceful. In ways, it's good and stuff because you get to calm. And through being out here kind of isolated and stuff, you get that spiritual aspect.
So, Steve, what comes next? What do you want to learn? How do you want to grow in the training program? And what do you think God is going to call you to do next after the program?
Right now, I just want to concentrate on God and do my daily work and stuff. Like I said, I'm just getting back connected to God, and I'm not quite there to find out what God is ready for me to do yet.
Well, thank you so much, Steve, for talking with us. And we want you to pray for Steve and the other men who are out here. He needs your prayers as God guides him and leads him while he's here in the training program. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
I noticed that when Chris is playing his music, his gospel music, you're singing along. Why do you do that?
I was raised in church. My father was a Southern Baptist preacher. My twin brother and I always had a strong desire to do music. We were writing little songs when we were little kids even. Okay. When the Jackson 5 band group was out and the Cow Sills and all those people, we found out that Michael was writing. And we were like, well, if he can do that, we can do that. Right. We can write music.
So what does it mean to have gospel songs sung here? How does that affect you?
I really enjoy it. It takes me back to a younger time in life. It helps escape the present, if you will. Okay. You know, the problems of today that come from being an adult, from growing up.
Is there a favorite song that Chris sings that you like, maybe in particular?
I think he did Chain Breaker, and I really like Chain Breaker. Okay. Zach Williams did that song. Uh-huh. And there's a recording of him doing it at Harding Prison. Uh-huh. And it shows a lot of the prisoners really getting into the music and singing and praising God. Right. You know, it's amazing what kind of doors of opportunity music opens for people and opens up their heart and their minds.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Kevin. I'm joined here with Linda. And Linda, when Chris Rice sings the songs, mm-hmm. the praise and worship songs, mm-hmm. what does it mean to you?
I am praise. I am worship. We are born at birth to worship and praise God. It's only in our growing up and our jadedness and our churches. I not only am a worshiper and a praiser, it takes me into the throne room face to face with Jesus. And it's the only thing that has kept me alive these 70 years. And that's my only safe place to go, is into the throne room in praise and worship. And it doesn't matter if it's country music. It doesn't matter if it's rock Christian. I mean, I grew up in Pentecostal things. I grew up where the Pentecostals were saying, oh, they're crazy. They hang off chandeliers. I never saw that once in my life. But I'm just saying, you don't have to have a great voice. It just says, open your mouth and praise the Lord. And that's, God wants to hear you praising Him and you worshiping Him. And we don't have to compare ourselves to somebody else we've heard or some other worship leader or some other choir that did it better than our church or that church or this church. Just open your heart. If you love the Lord, tell Him so. And you know, people say, oh, Linda, I can't do it like you, or I can't sing like you. You don't have to. Don't try to sing like anybody. Don't try to mimic anybody else. Be you. And all you have to do is lift your voice. If you are so totally off key, it's horrible, God will correct it when it gets to heaven.
Just make a joyful noise.
Make a joyful noise. So if it's always just, I just tell people, little kids, I've been training them since they were tiny up to the adult choirs and doing it all my life, basically. My daddy put me singing and playing the piano when I was five. Said, come on, girl, let's go. And I'm just saying, make a joyful noise. And don't, I had a lady tell me Sunday, but Linda, I can't do what you do. I said, don't try to do what I do. I said, you be you and you be free. She said, I can do it in my living room by myself. I said, then go into the church we're at with 1,000 members and you just pretend and look to God and say, I'm the only one here. I don't see these other 1,000 people, and you worship the Lord before the 1,000 because you don't have your eyes on them. You have it on the Most High God and Yeshua, your salvation. And then just pretend like you do it for an audience of one. An audience of one. Not doing it for the masses to applaud you. Just do it for Him. And anybody can do that, Pastor Mark.
Yeah, and praise is important to our life as Christians.
Yeah, it keeps us strong and healthy. People say, Linda, how can you do what you do? I said, because I've been doing this for a long time. And my daddy, I learned from the best. My daddy, my mother, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins. We didn't know anything else. And I remember as a little girl going to my grandma's church. It was a little Pentecostal church. It was quite different than the Baptist church. And when they had revival meetings, they'd get all the little kids up front. And they got their instruments going. Oh, dear Lord, we didn't do that in the Baptist church either. You know, the tambourines and the drums. And so, but I remember as a little kid, we'd get up there and we'd clap along with the music. And I saw people praising the Lord, lifting their hands. And I thought, this is a fun church to go to. I like going to a church like this. And I asked my Baptist preacher, Baptist-costal daddy preacher for 50 years, I said, Daddy, why don't we do that in the Baptist church? He goes, well, it's just kind of stuff we've been taught. And so I said, my daddy, you know what my daddy said? My last words he said before he went on to heaven 27 years ago, I called him and he died on the table in surgery. And I was 1,000 miles away. I said, Daddy, how are you? He goes, honey, I'm going to be in heaven soon. I know that. But he said, here's what I want you to do. You're doing it right. Don't you ever quit. And you keep telling people about Jesus until I see you and I'll meet you at the pearly gates and we'll be there. But he said, don't you keep telling them grandkids, you keep teaching it, you keep preaching it, you keep singing it, because that's what we've got to do. He had a vision into heaven. Well, he died on the table and kind of like Paul, he got real. He goes, honey, I can't tell you what I saw. He just kept going, I just can't. And I said, Daddy, I understand what you're saying. He said, I had a vision. And I said, Daddy, you don't have to say anything more. I said, it was kind of like Paul, right? He goes, yeah, I caught up the third heaven. I don't know. I just know. He said, all I'm saying, it was the last words that I ever heard my daddy say, and he was gone. And he said, you keep telling people about Jesus. Don't you ever quit, because you're doing the right thing. And he said, you keep praising the Lord, and you keep dancing, and you keep telling people about Jesus, and bring many sons unto glory. Romans. That we're bringing many sons and daughters unto glory. And sometimes just our worship and praise will strike somebody's heart. That they'll say, you know, maybe I need something like that. Only the Holy Spirit can lead you into the throne room. We don't do it because we dance big enough or praise loud enough. The Holy Ghost takes you into the throne room. And that's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
We love you, Linda. Thank you so much. for talking with us and also singing praises unto the Lord.
Yes, yes. And I will never stop. And you know what? We're going to be doing it for eternity, so we better get ready.
This is practice.
This is just practice. And you don't have to be a great singer to go to heaven and join the choir.
Right. Thank God. I probably wouldn't be there. But anyway, thank you, Linda.
Thank you, Pastor. Love you. And I, you know what? Jesus is really the number one and the only one. The only one. Our focus has to be on him.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Linda.
I'm here with Robert. Robert, you've been down here at Marshfield the longest. How long have you been down here in Marshfield?
Actually, I've been down here in Marshfield 1 year.
1 year. So, Robert, what is God doing in your season, in this season of life, for you right now?
Well, right now, since I've been here, he's gave me a lot of help learning how to deal with, you know, people that are in need, like I was in need. A lot of people come in here that are in need, and he gives me the patience to work with people that are in need and offer them the help that they need. So
sometimes we can get people in the program who you got to live and work with who can be really hard to live and work with, right? When I know that recently you had a lot of really hard experiences where it was just very challenging, right? How did God bring you through that?
Well, the thing about the Word of God says, wait on the Lord. And sometimes we get impatient and we don't wait on the Lord. And you got to keep praying and waiting, because there are people that don't follow Jesus Christ and God, and you know, they are full of anger, full of frustration, and they don't want to hear it. And you can't let that pull you away from what you're trying to do for God. You can't let that keep you from serving God and submitting God. And you can't let that fill you with anger either. So God is teaching me to start being more patient, more kind, and put things in the past and just keep moving forward for him.
Yeah, Galatians 5:22-23 says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. And against such things, there is no law, right? And so you are growing in the fruits of the Spirit, patience in particular, and self-control. Patience is long-suffering. And sometimes we have to suffer long with other people and bear with them. And so God is teaching you that right now. What comes next? What do you want to learn? Where do you want to go next while in the program?
Well, I'm not too sure where I'm going to go next, because God is just helping me work with the public and with the community. And it's teaching me that I can put the past behind me and I can fit in. And God wants me to keep following his word, keep doing the fruit of the Spirit, like you said, and keep learning how to help others. And that's where I want to go next. Is if I leave this program, I want to go out and I want God to put me in a position in the community where I can still serve him and still help others.
Praise the Lord. This is a man who's been changed by the newness of life. Jesus Christ has touched Robert, and he's continuing to work in him in a variety of different ways. And we need you to pray for Robert right now as he's in the program, and continue to pray that the Lord would use him and work in his life in many different ways while he's here and wherever he would go next. So please pray for Robert. Our residential training program is only possible because of people like you who see the needs, who see the lives who are being changed, and want to support the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. So we thank all of those who are donating and sponsoring and giving, sacrificially even, to the work of New Life, so that men and women can be changed for the glory of God.
Amen.
And so please consider giving today. And we thank you so much, Robert, for talking with us. And God bless you.
God bless you.